Okay. It's now very official, everything here with we have the Electron-Ion Collider announced. There's a light shining at us, and we are being recorded. So cannot get more official. So we are here for the detector full simulation tutorials. But before that, I would like to give with Andrea and Tore, we put some slides together, some overview where we are with the EIC User Group Software Working Group, which is our goals is we are providing a workflow environment for the EIC User Group. So we would like to have tools, documentation, and support to use this workflow environment, and we will. And this workflow environment will grow with user input. So we would like to get direction from users. We hope that users help us with documentation, either by asking questions about what is missing in the documentation, so even helping writing documentation, and then eventually also help with development of tools. This is very much connected to the Yellow Reports effort by the EIC User Group. So we, for instance, hope there to get discussions with the Physics Working Group, some idea about benchmark processes, and we need the input from the whole community for the detailed detector designs and on all the details on the reconstructions algorithms to really complete our tools. The software working group is part of both the physics working group and detector working group. You see here that so we are part of the discussions with the conveners, and we also have a subgroup in the detector working group. So our goal is really to organize and coordinate and also do the simulation effort for the yellow reports. So how you get started? On the website of the EIC User Group, there is a software top menu, and there you find some overview. You find here reference to our mailing list, to our repository, and to our starting website with more detailed information. What we propose for the yellow report is JupyterLab. That is a web-based interactive analysis environment. What you see here is one example, Jupyter Notebook. You, of course, have in this environment various of them, and you can also organize the files, etc. In these Jupyter Notebooks, you write your analysis code, for instance, in Python, but you also can do this in Root or C++. You directly have this link to the visualization of your results, and you can, with full LaTeX support, edit also the narrative of the analysis. So you can really link more or less your final output, which will be the report, meaning some text and some plots with the analysis code itself. Why JupyterLab? It's a bridge to modern data science. So I quote here a Nature paper, why Jupyter is data scientist computation notebook of choice. Alone on GitHub, there are more than 3 million public Jupyter notebooks available. And you also see here by just some example statistical languages, R, which was for a long time really redefining statistical analysis. You see here the rise of Jupyter Notebooks really taking over data science. It is a collaborative workspace to create and share Jupyter Notebooks. This is important for the collaborative approach of these yellow report studies. It is a web-based interactive analysis environment, so it is easily accessible. You can share the results, you can also reproduce someone's analysis, and it's fully extensible and modular. That means you can build a collection of analysis and of analysis tools. You can have is to say, well, this is all nice, but does it hide any complexity? not the way this is designed. So the interfaces between all of the internal layers are well defined, so that one can also replace one of the layers without having to replace the whole structure. This is, for instance, also shown here, that you can get access to not only the full logs of the program, but you can also get the full run command. So instead of just pressing a run button in a Jupyter notebook, you have here the full command, which you then also could just use on the command line. So you can switch easily between all of these layers. Of course, the more you go to the ground, the more you then really need to know all the details about the tools. Whereas here, you can just it's perhaps a good start from a user interface point of view. The software, so we have simulation of physics processes, something which will be discussed in the physics working group. Simulation of detector responses is why we are here today, which will be discussed in the detector working group. And of course, then we do an analysis of either some physics or detector results or some combined study. And so this is then relevant for the physics and detector working group. We have already set up a Monte Carlo event generators. There are more to come. There are tutorials about that in preparation. We on January 9th had tutorials on fast simulations. We are today here for the first tutorials on full simulations. And we also are planning tutorials on reconstruction, but very likely also today you will hear some first tutorials on, or some first insights on reconstruction. These are what we are planned regarding tutorials. Again, January 9th was very successful, so we had in total 79 participants. A recording is available. Today we are here, detector full simulations. We would like to repeat this on February 6th. And we did a survey. Thanks everyone for participating in this survey. And based on that, we will then also do follow-up tutorials. For sure, Monte Carlo and reconstruction is something which is a priority. In order to also reach out to us, we are building up a support team to just ensure timely answer to questions. We have a support mailing list, software support at EICUG.org. This is also a Google forum, so all the answers will be archived. And this is then a start of a knowledge base. And we also have set up the Slack workspace for the EICUG, where there's a software support channel where you can reach out to us regarding questions. So what is currently available? Let me start with the Monte Carlo event generators. All the generators which have been put together by the BNL task force, they are available. In addition to that, we are working with the international Monte Carlo community on the unique Monte Carlo requirements for EIC science. So for instance, Monte Carlo event generators for polarized EP, but also deuteron and helium-3. Of course, this needs to include all of these novel QCD phenomena, GPDs, TMDs, and we of course also need Monte Carlo for EA. The Monte Carlo community in the last two decades have focused on LHC. Among the lessons learned there, they're really high precision QCD measurements require also high precision Monte Carlo simulations. And one of the results is also that Monte Carlo is not only about tuning some simulations to some previous results. Due to this precision, you also can learn something about physics. So Monte Carlo itself is a theory tool. And now the community is ready to work on these requirements. This is, for instance, last year we had two workshops, one in Hamburg and one in Vienna, Austria, on this subject. So we are continuing these list of generators. Here is, for instance, another prominent example for EIC, eStarlight by Spencer Klein. And we are integrating the Monte Carlo here shown for Pythia 8 in the Jupiter Lab environment. You can see here some examples how to configure, and here some visualization. I skipped fast simulations because we talked about that in detail on January 9th. Regarding a full simulation, the tool of choice is of course JSON 4. We are working together with the JSON 4 International Collaboration. Makoto Asai is our liaison, and he helps us with coordinating input for JSON 4 validation based on an EIC physics list. And he is putting out recommendations about, for instance, what JSON version to use. So the latest version, which has been released at the end of last year, this is their recommendation. We also had a technical forum organized on September 24th. Many of us participated in that. One of the drivers for EIC is, of course, that the energy range of an EIC is different from LHC experiments. So there needs to be some validation tuning and also extensions done, including some test beam studies. In particular, because EIC is an interesting overlap region between existing models. So in this technical forum, we clarified that all the detectors and physics simulations rely on JSON 4. Knowledge transfer is different. For instance, something which we discuss in more details are these tessellated solids. It is helpful to continue maintaining this EIC physics list, which will of course will grow over time. And we had a request for improved photonuclear and electronuclear reactions, something which has been put into the latest version, the 10.6 release of JSON 4. For our JSON 4 infrastructure for the EIC user group, there are two requirements. One is the EIC generic detector R&D program, which requests a simple light setup with a well-defined geometry description standard that is easy to use. And the EIC user group who would like to have a flexible accelerator and detector interface with full support of existing interaction region designs and detector concept. In the scope of the yellow reports, there's the idea to discuss various detector concepts, also complementarity between IP1 and IP2 detectors. And we had detailed discussions on that. I link here EIC software meeting where we met in person in July here at Brookhaven and September 24th at Jefferson Lab. And then we had follow-up meetings where we discussed this in far more detail. So this is our approach. We present a common repository for detector R&D for EIC. We agreed on, as a detector description, JSON 4, and are not yet, for instance, thinking about tools like DD4HAP, because we think that most of the sub-detectors which are being developed are written in JSON 4. We started with some common detector naming conventions. We have been thinking about some common HITS output structure, and after these tutorials, we'll work on some concise document and template how to integrate that based on what we see in today's tutorial. What we propose are two solutions, detector simulations in Fun4All or in G4E. Let me go a little bit more in detail about that. We will hear, of course, far more details in the tutorials. So Fun4All is a mature framework which is based on root, and you work with it with root macros, which allow you to steer your analysis. It is modular, so each detector which you have in, so for instance here in a complex EIC detector, is its own entity, and you don't need to modify the framework, its code itself, in order to add new detectors. And how this will work in detail, Chris will show you in a bit. And then you combine detectors using root macros. You already in yesterday's email read about singularity containers and the CERN virtual machine file system, where you can find the software, and more details will be shared about how this works and how you can work in this environment. Part of a mature framework is, of course, that you have daily builds and continuous integration to ensure the quality of your model. You have interfaces to smearing, this EIC smear detector, which we have presented in the January 9th tutorial. And you already have detector configurations in, for instance, the EIC as Phoenix variant, or part of the Jefferson Lab EIC detector concept. And it, of course, has not only been used for ongoing work and at Phoenix and as Phoenix, but it was also the basis for an EIC detector letter of intent. And it's for the modularity, with each detector being its own entity, also important that you can implement generic volumes on a macro level. Some nice pictures here, and I don't go so much about this in details about how you do this with the how to integrate an existing detector into Fun for All. There will be a 2-hour detailed presentation on how to do that. The motivation for G4E, and also you will in the afternoon hear about that, is to have a standalone C++ JN4 application. It has inputs to various EIC Monte Carlo file formats, HAPMC for all the modern generators, the PIFIA 6 Lund format, and the Beagle format, which uses a lot of extensions to the previous PIFIA 6 format. It has some integration with accelerator elements, and it has, of course, the infrastructure to import JN4 detector geometry and simulation codes. More details 2 p.m. this afternoon. The design goals is to have the ability to have several master detectors and interaction regions, ability to easily import JN4 standalone detector implementations, and ways to send the right configuration to a sub-detector depending on a selected master detector, so that one detector implementation could serve for different interaction regions. So the sub-detectors are here. You would integrate one, and then you can put it into other existing detector concepts here called master detectors. And how this will be imported in detail will be shown in today's tutorial by Dimitri. What is also important is accelerator interface. We have a collider. There are beamline elements in the interaction regions, which of course have consequences on available space. They limit the acceptance. And so we need to get the accelerator design in. It's also important in particular parts like a beam pipe to have already their existing engineering information in, import that into JN4. And so we have a prototype for this is available, and there's a common interface which is under active development. The question which is obvious to ask is why two question options. So when this yellow report started, there is ongoing developments for two full simulations. Again, Fun for All originated from Phoenix as Phoenix. It's mature and it's centered around the use of root macros. G4E, which was built up for the EIC, of course, in comparison to Fun for All, is in a younger stage of development and has been constructed as a pure JSON 4 application and is integrated in the JupyterLab environment I have been talked about earlier. Of course, Fun for All can be also fully integrated in that JupyterLab environment. Each of these solutions is supported by a core team of developers, and we put forward both options and letting you, the users, to decide which one you would like to use, mainly also because of your coding preferences. However, it's also important that having various tools available is important to cross-check important results and also improve our confidence in the outcome of the simulations. So while from a user point of view, it would be perhaps easier to say there is only one and only one tool, having actually the freedom to choose between these tools and also to check result between these tools will be important for the yellow reports and also work afterwards. A few minutes on reconstruction of just a few slides. So there are reconstruction options available. I put them in alphabetical order. There is ACTS emerging, a common tracking software, which emerged out from the ATLAS software, and Berkeley Nuclear Physics and High Energy Physics are looking into this for the EIC. This generic framework and experiment independent track reconstruction software sounds very promising for the EIC, but of course it has to be really shown how well it works and how, for instance, it can be expanded. TPCs, for instance, are not included here. One option for tracking is EIC root. I have one slide on that. Ejana, which is, for instance, also used for the fast simulations, has a GenFit and Rafe tracking in. It's based on Jana 2 for EIC data reconstruction and data analysis. I have one slide in on Jana 2. And of course, last but not least, Fun for All. And I assume that Chris will talk about some reconstruction there. For EIC root, EIC root, you have also Docker image available where you can use that. And it's a tool which will be helpful for some example tracking studies. And you see an example here of a vertex tracker and a TPC and some examples, event display, some code, and you see here the basic configuration. For Jana 2, just to mention that, this is a C++ event processing framework. It has a factory model with a demand interface, so it's a very nice user-centered design. It is multi-threaded with more than 10 years of experience, and it has a plugin support which provides mechanisms for many physicists to contribute and getting the multi-threadal external to the contributed code. So for instance, Jana has been used as a parallelizer of existing software, for instance, in one simulation code Argon put together for the EIC. It is currently going to its next revision, its active development for Jana 2. Motivation for that is C++ really developed rapidly and to take advantage of that, have a Python interface, and also this is connected to streaming readout work, which is going on at Jefferson Lab. So let me summarize by reminding you what Tori already mentioned, the agenda for today's meeting. So the focus is detector full simulation tutorial. We, for instance, want to show how to implement and integrate and sub-detector in existing detector concepts, how to modify an existing detector concept. So we will hear from Jaroslav about his implementation of a luminosity monitor, which we will use as example for a subdetector, then to put into the full simulations. At 10, Chris will then give a tutorial how to do that for fun for all. I linked here the quick start, and I linked here also the download of the Singularity container. If you have not done this, really do this so to be ready for the tutorial. Chris, first a quick start. Is there anything you would like to mention for everyone to be prepared in half an hour?
It depends how far you have to go down. I mean, these are all of them are, you know, 4 or 5 gigabyte file sized files. So, you know, download them now and you might be ready in about half an hour.
We can run it.
Or you can run it in an RCF account. If it has an RCF account, you can run it there. Okay. You should run NX.
For G4E, the quick start is the same as for the fast simulations, but it's a different container. The link is here, and Dimitri told me this morning that there will be a small update, but I think if you do it, Docker works nicely with layers. You have it already ready and then just updated it perhaps over the lunch break. And then we would like to have some discussion about Greenfield. So we already think here a lot about software for the EIC and talk about possible designs for the EIC software. And it's important to somehow put this into the overall nuclear physics and HCP software and computing landscape. And so this afternoon, we talked a little bit about what we are doing here. What does this really mean with respect to requirements and drivers for software and computing? So this will be then the end of the day. And then we have dinner at
Painters, it's called, 15 minutes away.
And I hope you will all join us today. And then we also have perhaps some already get some lively feedback on the tutorials. That was everything from my side. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Marcus.
Jarrod.
Hey. Now, Jarrod is up. Down for luminosity.